Alright, well, tonight, Lord willing, we'll take a look at a study called Divide the Living Child. Elizabeth, hi, welcome. Just give me 1 second. You know, this study, Divide the Living Child, the account we read in 1 Kings chapter 3, starting in verse 16. It's a very complex set of information, so I'm going to be sharing some verses for consideration, and hopefully, if you've looked at this account, you might be you're welcome to offer additional information or correction, because there's some verses here I think we're going to see where God appears to be going back and forth. From the Great Tribulation itself to the time when Christ is actually revealed. And so we'll start with 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 16. And we'll take a look at the two harlots and raise the question whether or not it's the unsaved church in tribulation. Why is God speaking of two harlots? What does the number two signify, for the most part, in the Bible? Verse 16, then came there two women that were harlots unto the king and stood before him. Any idea why God would ye... Yeah, the churches. Why is God speaking of harlots? And I think we're going to see later on that one of these actually, I believe, is a picture of the elect body, or a picture of Christ, and the other a picture of the wicked, the unsaved in the body. But can you see here why from time to time, yeah, it is the two witnesses. It is the two witnesses. It encompasses, I believe, the whole Word of God, the law and the prophets, Moses and Elijah. But do you suppose that it's significant that God is making reference here to harlots? You know, from time to time, I speak of the body coming into the Great Tribulation. God is looking at the whole body as unclean. The whole body as unclean. And you know, sometimes people have a very hard time with this, because in their minds, they're thinking, well, the believers, once they're saved, then God has nothing... but good things to say about them. And he does. Individually, he does. But by God's grace, I think when we look at the overall theme of the Bible, as far as the church body itself coming into the Great Tribulation, God there again appears to be looking at the body as if it's your body or my body that is unsaved, right? And that's why we read about God brings about a separation, come out of her, my people. So I think it's interesting here that God is making reference to the two women as harlots. It's as if, you know, the believers also, they're committing, they're identified with the unclean, they're identified with Babylon. So that's the picture that I'm getting here. We read in Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 29. I will save you from all your uncleanness, and I will call for the corn. Roundabout, hi, welcome. I will call for the corn and will increase it and lay no famine upon you. Now God speaks of a famine of hearing coming on the body. Judgment begins at the house of God. The believers are chastised. And then God saves, he redeems the body. And that's how I think, Lord willing, we might begin to appreciate the language that God is using here. It's as if these two women, they are harlots. They identify with the kingdom of Babylon. When Satan takes his seat in the temple, God hides his face. The whole body is unclean, and then God comes and he redeems the body. In Ezekiel 36, verse 31, then shall ye remember your own evil ways and your doings that were not good. See that? So this is a time now when God brings revelation to the believers. And now they understand why the whole body had come under the wrath of God. Because even the believers, would you agree that the believers at some point, they, the doctrine that they were teaching may not have been altogether faithful to the Word of God, right? Would you agree with that? Yeah. The believers had a lot of doctrine today. You know, by God's grace, the believers are being corrected. The believers are finding correction. Why? Because God is opening up the Bible. Now they receive the word to speak. But if they too, if they were preaching hell and damnation, they were sharing a lot of things from the Bible that were not altogether accurate, well, then God was not idle, right? Now, God does not forsake them because individually they would have been sealed. But as far as the body, because the body is the body of Christ, until God actually comes and begins to purge the body, well, God, I believe, is looking at the whole body as unclean. And so all of us, you know, myself, you, anyone prior to God unsealing the Bible, we would have had our own doctrine, our own method of understanding the Bible. And now God, in His mercy, He begins to bring correction. Then shall ye remember your own evil ways and your doings that were not good, and shall loathe yourselves in your own sight for your iniquities. Ezekiel 36, verse 32. Not for your sakes do I this, saith the Lord. Be it known unto you, be ashamed and confounded for your own ways, O house of Israel. So can you see in the historical account, even the nation of Israel, it's the whole nation really, many times would go after a different gospel. They would follow, they would go after the heathen nations, and God was angry with the whole nation. And yet He would have mercy on them, right? He sends them a judge, and the judge would begin to deliver them from the hand of the enemies, which I believe is a beautiful picture of God redeeming the body today from the hand of the wicked. Not for your sakes do I this, saith the Lord. Be it known unto you, be ashamed and confounded for your own ways, O house of Israel. Genesis chapter 17, verse 25. And you know, I've puzzled over this for some time. Why is it that God is speaking of Ishmael, who is a son of the bondwoman, and that he was circumcised at the age of 13? And we understand that circumcision is really pointing to salvation. And here again, I think in the context, God is really looking at Ishmael. Very interesting account. I do see this by God's grace in a number of places in the Bible. God is looking at that portion of the body that is unclean. And then He speaks of redeeming that body. He redeems it. Like Ishmael here is actually being circumcised, means that the body is going to receive circumcision. And that would be the corporate salvation that we talk about from time to time. Same thing here, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 15. If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss, but himself shall be saved, yes, so as by fire. So again, God makes a distinction between the believers and the wicked. And then He focuses on the wicked as if now He's looking at the wicked as the body that needs to be redeemed. So that's why I think from time to time we can see where God begins to speak of healing that which is unclean. Same picture I think we see here, Genesis chapter 20, verse 17. Abraham prayed unto God and God healed Abimelech. Now Abimelech was a wicked man. Remember, he had taken Sarah, Abraham's wife, and he wanted to lie with her. And then God came to him in a dream. And then finally, he restored Sarah, the man's wife. And yet God is speaking of healing Abimelech. And you notice the language here. His wife, his maidservants, and they bear children. That's the language of salvation. So when we understand that in the context, looking at a wicked man like Abimelech, well, in this language appears to make sense, Lord willing. Revelation chapter 13, verse 13, same concept here again. And I saw one of his heads as it were wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed. You know, this is a very difficult passage. And on the surface, and I'm sure you'll agree, and because this is the way that I've understood this, on the surface it appears to be looking at a time when Satan, he was wounded, and now he comes at the time of the tribulation. Now he is alive. Now he is back on the scene. But is this what this verse is teaching? You might see here how it's very difficult to, you know, if we're not allowing the rest of the Bible to speak, to define the terms, we might come to that conclusion. But I propose here again that God is speaking of healing the body. Well, what's interesting here, and very ominous, I think, is that God is speaking of the beast. You know, many times we think of the beast and we're thinking, oh, well, that's the church, right? You agree with that? We think of the beast and we're like, oh yeah, that's the church. That doesn't have anything to do with the believers. But then we start looking at the Bible carefully, where God says judgment begins at the house of God. God redeems the body. Then shall ye remember your own evil ways and your doings that were not good. And then we begin to see perhaps that, yeah, this does appear to make sense. Because God is looking at the whole body prior to the separation. And that's the beast, I think, that's in view here. It is the unsaved body. But then God heals the wound. He brings the elect. He begins to bring the believers out of Babylon. The wound that came on the head of the beast, I propose it is the whole church body coming into the great tribulation. And then we have the depart out. Okay, so very interesting verse here. The deadly wound was healed. Now, the reason I share these verses is to try and establish the setting here, to understand that the two women that I mentioned earlier, two harlots coming into this time of tribulation, and then they are going to bear children. They bear children. They are both delivered, yet one of them died, and the other child lives. Very interesting account. Verse 17, 1 Kings chapter 3. And the one woman said, O my Lord, I and this woman dwell in one house, and I was delivered of a child with her in the house. What does it mean to be delivered? Remember I posted just now, I made reference to Abimelech. God healed Abimelech and they were able to bear children. And that appears to be the language of salvation. I think the same is in view when we look at the nature of the church body. When God begins to separate the wheat from the tares. Verse 18, it came to pass the third day after that I was delivered, that this woman was delivered also. And we were together. There was no stranger with us in the same house, in the house, save we two in the house. ACB, welcome. Michael, hi, welcome. Okay, take a look at John chapter 16, verse 21. A woman, when she is in travail, hath sorrow because her hour is come. But as soon as she is delivered of the child, she remembereth no more the anguish for joy that a man is born into the world. What is this talking about? Anyone? Any idea? A woman, when she is in travail, have sorrow. And I think, Elizabeth, you've mentioned this before in the past. The idea of weeping endures for a night. And joy comes in the morning, right? A woman, when she is in travail, have sorrow. Who is the woman that is travailing? Wouldn't this be a picture of the whole body again coming into the great tribulation? Yeah. the body, the church body, comes into the great tribulation, there is sorrow, there is weeping. There is sorrow. Weeping endures for a night. But then when she delivers, when she is delivered of the child, now she has joy. Salvation. Salvation, the redemption of the body. The deadly wound is healed. So this, I believe, is just another picture that God is giving us of the nature of the salvation of the body, the depart out. When she is delivered of the child, she remembers no more the anguish. Isaiah chapter 66, verse 7. Before she travailed, she brought forth. Now in this context, God appears to be showing that he does not allow the whole body, right, especially the elect, to endure the full brunt of the tribulation. And so we see another picture. Before she travailed, she brought forth. Before her pain came, she was delivered of a man-child. But the unsaved, you know, the other harlot, she too, she is delivered of a child. Verse 19, and this woman's child died in the night because she overlaid it. Now, what's interesting here, I'm not sure if I understand the full meaning of overlay. It appears to be related to lying down with. And in this context, I think the picture that we're getting is that this woman, while she was sleeping, she turned over the child. In other words, she squished the child to death, is what it appears to be talking about. But the word overlay here is very interesting. I'm not going to get into details, tonight. Maybe, Lord willing, we'll look at it a little bit closer. So this woman's child died in the night. So who would actually die? What is the night referring to? What is the night pointing to? Remember, the night cometh when no man can work? Yeah, the night, we're looking at the great tribulation. And this woman's child died in the night. She died in the night. What about Hosea chapter 9, verse 16? Ephraim is smitten, their root is dried up, they shall bear no fruit. Yea, though they bring forth, yet will I slay even the beloved fruit of their womb. Can you see how perhaps there is a tie in there where both the women, the harlots, they bring forth? We know the believers, they bring forth unto salvation. And God here is saying that the unsaved in a body, even though they bring forth, they bear children. But what happens? I will slay even the beloved fruit of their womb. So in other words, a child that they bear does not survive. Isn't that interesting? And that might be the picture that we're looking at here with the other harlot. She has a child, and the child dies in the night. Job chapter 34, verse 20. In a moment shall they die, and the people shall be troubled at midnight. See the word trouble there? Tribulation. Midnight. Darkness comes over the land. The people shall be troubled at midnight and pass away. So again, I do see that there is a connection there. But then God here again appears to be going back. That's my impression of this, of the verses that we're going to look at here. Even though, you know, we're talking about the two women bearing children, which appears to be a language of the depart out. But yet, now there's a switch that comes in the night. And given the nature of some of these verses, God, and this is not unusual, of course, God appears to be going back to pre-depart out. Now, if anyone has any other input on this, it's actually welcome. I'd be willing to look at it. But notice here in 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 20, she arose at midnight and took my son from beside me, while thine handmaid slept. Now, perhaps this could also be talking. We might be looking at the same time frame, the same time period. But if you look at some of these verses, you might see perhaps why I'm proposing that God appears to be going back to pre-depart out. But we're still looking at the Great Tribulation. We're still looking at a time when the whole church body is under the wrath of God. At the start of the tribulation, the believers are chastised. It is a partial darkening, earthquakes in diverse places. And then God begins to bring about the separation. So she arose at midnight and took my son from beside me. Well, that's interesting. What did she do? If she took the child, a child that was not hers, does not belong to her, what is she actually doing? What is she doing? Isn't she stealing the child? Yeah. She is stealing the child. And we read here in Job 24:14, the murderer rising with the light killeth the poor and needy, and in the night is as a thief. Isn't that interesting? So now we're looking at a thief. But we know that the unsaved, the locust, the wicked in the body, God makes reference to them as such. So we can see perhaps that now we're looking at God allowing the locusts. Now they rise, they kill the two witnesses. Like we read here in Genesis 4 verse 8, Cain rose up against Abel his brother and slew him. Also Deuteronomy chapter 28 verse 7. The Lord shall cause thine enemies to rise up against thee, to be smitten before thy face. They shall come out against thee one way and flee before thee seven ways. So the enemy rises. And again, the reason I propose that this appears to be going back to pre-depart out, because that's the time when the Antichrist began to rule in the church body. Oops, hold on 1 second. So the enemy rises, and now they put to death the two witnesses. John 10:10, the thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life. Matthew chapter 13 verse 25, while men slept. That's an interesting verse. While men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among them, right, among the wheat. Matthew 25 verse 5, while the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. Now here's another verse. Not sure how it relates directly, but it does seem to tie into the context. The time when the soldiers that were guarding the body of Christ, they were afraid when actually Christ was resurrected, and so they made up the story saying that to tell that the leaders, that his disciples came by night and stole him away while we slept. So I think we're still looking at the nature of the theft that is going on here. The unsaved in a body, they rise in the night, they kill the two witnesses, they steal the child. Okay, now in verse 21 in 1 Kings chapter 3, when I rose in the morning to give my child suck, behold, it was dead. When I had considered it in the morning, behold, it was not my son, which I did bear. Okay, so now, let me get verse 22. And the other woman said, nay, but the living is my son, and the dead is thy son. Can anyone tell me what God appears to be telling us here? Why is it that this woman has actually taken the child And now she is claiming that the living child is her son. What comes to mind? Now keep in mind that we're still looking at the Great Tribulation. What is the nature of the Great Tribulation? We know that Antichrist is ruling. False gospels, deceivers. Yeah, that's true, Elizabeth. But why is it that, what is it that the false gospels, the false prophets, what is it that they claim? What are they doing when they are ruling in tribulation? Yes, exactly. They say they have Christ. They have the living waters. So now it's a role reversal. The dead claim to be alive. And it's also the time of the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. Evil appears to be good and good appears to be evil. So can you see how this woman who actually steals the child, it's as if now she is claiming to have Christ. She is claiming the living child. And at the same time, she says, well, no, your child is dead. The believers, they've been put to death. The elect, Antichrist is ruling. Isn't that interesting? So they claim to have the living child. The living child is my son, she says. Now we know, looking at a few of these verses, Isaiah chapter 38, verse 19. The living, he shall praise thee. God is concerned with the living. But now we come into the great tribulation. The dead, the unsaved in a body, they claim to be alive. Many shall come in my name saying, I am. Luke chapter 20, verse 38, for he is not a God of the dead, but of the living. And this is a verse that I just mentioned, Mark chapter 13, verse 6. Many shall come in my name saying, I am alive. My child is living. Your child is dead. What about Luke chapter 17, verse 33? Whosoever shall seek to save his life shall lose it. And whosoever shall lose his life shall preserve it. Now, wouldn't it be the case here, this woman is trying to save her life or the life of the child. But yet, the child doesn't belong to her. She stole the child. Very interesting picture. Verse 23, 1 Kings chapter 3. Then said the king, the one saith, this is my son that liveth, and thy son is dead. And the other said, nay, but thy son is dead, and my son is the living. And the king said, bring me a sword. What is that? What is this sword that Solomon is asking for? Bring me a sword. And they brought a sword before the king. Yeah, it's the word of God. Yeah, it's the Bible. Now, isn't it today that God is cutting away, right? There's a separation. There's a separation, the word of God, when Christ is actually revealed. But you see, coming into the great tribulation, you remember how God is looking at the whole body as unclean? And let me go back to a verse that I posted earlier, I think in the book of Ezekiel, where God says, not for your sakes do I this, be it known, Ezekiel 36, verse 32. Be it known unto you, be ashamed and confounded for your own ways, O house of Israel. And then there's another verse, I'm not sure if I posted this verse here. Ray writes, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, for the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. Yes, Amen. Piercing event of the dividing asunder in soul and spirit. Yeah, that's the Bible. That's the Word of God. God is using the wicked today to use, you know, and as far as God judging the unsaved, He gives them over to the locust. But at the same time, it is the Word of God that is bringing about a separation. The believers, they find Christ. And Matthew posted Ezekiel 38:21, "And I will call for a sword against them throughout all my mountains, saith the Lord God. Every man's sword shall be against his brother." Amen. Amen. Very good verse. Did I post this verse? Let's see. Take a look at Isaiah chapter 27, verse 13. I don't think I posted this verse, but I do think that it relates. "And it shall come to pass in that day that the great trumpet shall be blown, and they shall come which were ready to perish in the land of Assyria, and the outcast in the land of Egypt, and shall worship the Lord in the holy mountain at Jerusalem." Now, you know what? Mark, hi, welcome back. There is no way, and I try to be very careful about this, Lord willing. We want to make sure that we understand that God does speak in the context of when He looks at the whole body, He sees the body as unclean. Notice the language here very, very carefully. "The trumpet shall be blown, and they shall come which were ready to perish." Isn't that strange language? What is that talking about? Well, I posted earlier that God says, because of your iniquities, the believers coming into the Great Tribulation identify with the harlot, they identify with the unclean. Many of us, prior to God bringing correction, we might have been using the Word of God unfaithfully. But can you see how, again, when we look at the nature of God redeeming the body, the reason for this salvation, for this redemption, is that now God has, you know, the believers, the third part, they've been brought through the fire. God has refined them. He has judged them. Judgment begins at the house of God. And then he speaks of no longer hiding His face from them. But if God was hiding His face from the elect, I propose that it was a form of judgment. They shall come. Who shall come? Well, those that were ready to to perish. Now that God is bringing back the captivity of His people. Okay, so now we're looking at the sword. The king calls for a sword, and he is going to divide the living child. He is going to bring death and destruction to this child. We read here in verse 25, "And the king said, divide the living child in two, and give half to the one and half to the other." That's kind of interesting, because the half and half, we see that a number of times where there is salvation and judgment. Half of the city shall go forth into captivity, and the residue of the people shall not be cut off from the city. So that's kind of interesting. And then we read in Ezekiel 37, verse 11. The word divide there is the word cut off. Now this seems to be tying in to the verse that I just posted now, Isaiah chapter 27, verse 13. In this verse here, Ezekiel 37, 11, "Then he said unto me, Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Behold, they say, our bones are dried, and our hope is lost. We are cut off." See, again, church body coming into the great tribulation. God is looking at the whole body as being cut off. The whole body is under the wrath of God corporately. They were ready to perish. Our bones are dry. There's no hope. And then we read about the earthquake. The bones now begin to come together, bone to his bone. Salvation, right? Oh, actually, you know what? I did have that verse, Isaiah 27, verse 13. I was getting ahead of myself there a little bit, but yeah, that's the emphasis that I wanted to make here in verse 13. All right, now let's look at see if I can post. I think I have to break this up. 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 26. Then spake the woman whose living child was unto the king, for her bowels yearned upon her son. What is that talking about? Anything come to mind? Now this one of the two women here, her bowels yearned upon her son, and she said, "Oh my Lord, give her the living child, and in no wise slay." But the other said, "Let it be neither mine nor thine, divide it." What comes to mind when we think of, now this woman already, she begins to have what? She begins to be compassionate, right, towards the child. Genesis chapter 43, verse 20. And Joseph made haste, for his bowels did yearn upon his brother. Isn't that interesting? Who is Joseph a picture of? Who is he typifying? Joseph, prime minister, right, in Egypt. He saves the family from the famine. So yeah, definitely, he has to be a picture of Christ. But you notice here that his bowels did yearn, right? He had compassion on them. And I think that's the same thing we're looking at here. Isaiah chapter 49, verse 15. Can a woman forget her suckling child, that she should not have compassion on the son of her womb? So can we begin to see, based on the language here, that God is already telling us that the woman who is the real mother of this child, the real mother of this child, we begin to see that she is giving evidence that the child does belong to her. What about the other one? Well, John chapter 10, verse 13. The hireling fleeth because he is an hireling, and careth not for the sheep. That's why we read here in verse 26, let it be neither mine nor thine. Satan doesn't care for the body, does he? There's no compassion there. Remember, the thief comes but to kill, to steal, and to destroy. So I think this is pretty significant. Elizabeth writes, makes me think of this verse, Mark chapter 3, verse 25. And if a house be divided against itself, that house can... Yes, amen. Thank you for sharing that. That does relate, because the kingdom of Satan is divided. There is no compassion. There is no yearning of the bowels. So yeah, we can understand how, you know, God could be looking at this woman here as a thief. Verse 27, 1 Kings chapter 3. Then the king answered and said, give her the living child, and in no wise slay it. She is the mother thereof. Isn't that a beautiful account? And we read in Galatians chapter 4, verse 26. But Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all. Very, beautiful picture I think God is giving us here, where we are looking at the nature of the body, again, coming into the Great Tribulation. All right, I wanted to hold off, but I think I can offer a conclusion, although it's tentative. The reason I say this is because of the timing, looking at the timing. On the one hand, God appears to be focusing on the revelation of Christ, and yet he goes back, it seems, to a time of pre-depart out. I don't think it changes the image or the picture that we're getting here. in this account. But I do want to make it tentative. Lord willing, if more information comes about that would confirm it, then yeah, you know, we'll talk some more about that. The account of the two harlots who brought forth children appears to relate to the church body at the revelation of Christ. The wicked stealing the child appears to relate to pre the part out. Hold on 1 second. Solomon wanting to divide the living child. He is a picture of... Wouldn't you say that Solomon is a picture of God himself? Would that be a fair statement? He is the judge. Yeah. So Solomon wanting to divide the living child seems to refer to the unsaved body under judgment prior to the separation. And at the same time, it seems to be a test, doesn't it? It seems to be a test where God is actually seeing who the real mother of the body is. Very, very interesting. How do we know? Well, the same language that we're reading here. We see one woman, right? One of the two. She had compassion on the child. Her bowels did yearn. Whereas the other one shows no remorse. No indication that there is compassion there. So yeah, very interesting account. Hold on 1 second.